So thank you for talking to Latest TV. Our council is a big character in the Great Escape, in the music industry, in the music world generally. And I heard yesterday you guys made an announcement.
Yeah.
What was that?
So the last Great Escape that happened in 2019, right, we announced a fund specifically for grassroots music and music venues, partly to encourage them to apply to us for funding, because historically they hadn't really done that. So that's worked really well. And of course, we had the pandemic in the middle of all that, which sort of, you know, was a bit of an inconvenient blip. But it's been 3 years now. We just announced another year of it. So that'll be a total of, I can't do the maths on that, £6 million we would have put into sort of grassroots music venues in the last 4 years, which is great. So yeah, that was our announcement yesterday. And we've worked, you know, really closely with venues over the last few years, a lot, you know, including venues that are based here in Brighton, to not least through the pandemic, keep them alive, you know.
Absolutely. So I had grassroots venue are obviously like the base of what new music feed on.
Yeah.
But how the concept actually can be developed further to sustain, yes, music venue, grassroots music venue, and the artists at the same time. And what was the selection method that you guys use for identify a grassroots venue, for instance?
I mean, you know, the term grassroots music venue is a sort of a widely used one now these days. I think it tends to, I mean, you know, there's no definite criteria, but I mean, in my mind, it's those venues that are perhaps up to kind of 500 capacity. They can be everything from sort of quite small 30, 50 capacity rooms to, you know, art centres and another sort of 300-400 capacity. But I mean, in terms of the criteria of our fund, it's really just that, you know, that they were, a lot of it's to do with what they're programming, particularly if they're programming original music, that's, you know, that's what we want to see. I mean, those venues effectively are the kind of research and development areas of the music industry. And if you didn't have those venues, then you wouldn't have a lot of the acts, you know, in many cases. So it's important to keep them alive. And, you know, and trading conditions for those venues have got really difficult over the last few years. So, you know, hopefully our funding has helped, you know, to an extent. I mean, I know there's other initiatives now and things in place to sort of further help music venues, not least the work that Music Venue Trust are doing, which is, you know, who we've worked with quite closely as well. So I think there's a lot more recognition generally that those venues are really important. They're really important culturally as well as economically, and they, you know, we should do everything we can to protect them.
So how do Great Escape stands in all this?
I mean, obviously the Great Escape itself is the sort of UK's, you know, major showcase festival, which is obviously showcasing the venues as well as the artists. I mean, I think it's interesting. I mean, how long has it been going now, Great Escape? 20 years or something?
Yeah.
It feels like it's changed quite a bit in that time. And I think there's a lot of, it feels generally to me, there's a lot more hunger for like new music and a lot more willingness to go and see bands and artists that you don't really know on a whim to sort of check out. So there's, I think, there could be all sorts of reasons for that, whether it's kind of Spotify or Six Music or whatever, but there seems to be a real hunger for sort of new music, which is great, of course. But that furthers the case of saying that's why small venues are really important, because that's where they come from, that's where they develop their craft, you know.
And of course, the social media represents like a virtual venue for all those bands that may play still in venue with like 20, 30 capacity, but it may have like a, you know, fans, 2 million fans on their Spotify or whatever. And yeah. This actually, I noticed it reflects quite a lot yesterday in all the bands I've seen, like, with 1.2 million followers on, and people from Brighton were actually singing their song like along.
Yeah, I know, I've noticed that. I was at Sound City in Liverpool a couple of weeks ago, and I noticed the same thing as that. And I mean, it's crazy, really. I mean, it's great that accessibility to, and I guess it's about, you know, just, I mean, I think the ways that artists develop their audiences now, you know, very different, and it's all about being available on, you know. I mean, I think it's partly about understanding who your audience is as an artist and the best way to reach them and communicate to them. But the artists that get it right, you can see that they're clearly, you know, building a following very quickly. And yeah, when you see a band, yeah, as you say, like in a room with 30 people, everyone knows the. It's great, isn't it? Really.
Absolutely. So is the Art Council planning of increasing the amount of money artists get out of those platforms like Spotify or YouTube?
Well, that's not up to us to decide what Spotify do with their money.
The internal market as a country gets regulated by, in this case, I guess, the Art Council is the main subject that they should at least introduce the idea of like investing more in the artists from the platforms. Do you think is the right way to go forward? Because in the end of the day, as a classic example of an artist, it has a, you know, 5,000 downloads and you get the 0.5p of revenue.
It's a different model, isn't it? It's a different market. I mean, clearly there's pressure from the artist community, from Spotify and others to pay a higher royalty level. I mean, it's a difficult... I mean, there's all sorts of arguments to that, because, I mean, Spotify is a revenue share model, isn't it? It's, you know, it's not the same as... I mean, the idea is, whatever we collect, we'll divide it up between you all, and, you know, there's all sorts of counter-arguments to that. But, I mean, the bottom line is, artists don't sell... Artists don't earn from Spotify like they used to earn from record sales in the past. But I think you just have to accept that and look at this sort of the wider, holistic picture. I mean, yes, we're, you know, the Arts Council all about artists getting paid, but I think that's about managing a multitude of income streams in many ways, and, you know, whether it's having a portfolio career or, you know, the mix between live and recording work, you know, whatever that is. But I mean, I understand the pressures, but it's just one of those. I think we're still in that transition, really, in terms of the old music industry becoming whatever it's going to become. You know, but do I think Spotify should pay artists more money? Well, yeah, of course I do, but then I would say that, wouldn't I? So, you know.
So, from your personal point of view, how do you see the future of a grassroots venue and independent music?
I think the venues are in a good place, having survived the pandemic. You know, there was a big worry. So going forward, there seems to be some good plans in place, you know, to keep them alive and keep them thriving. What I'd like to see in cities and towns is a stronger appreciation of how particularly the night kind of economy is boosted by music, and actually put that in their planning so that we don't have these issues where venues are turfed out by landlords, but also just to understand the value of music, you know, culturally as well as economically, you know, whether it's a, you know, small market town or a large city, you know, have that as part of your cultural and economic planning. And I think that'll help everybody, you know.